name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen. በስመ አብ ወወልድ ወመንፈስ ቅዱስ አሃዱ አምላክ አሜን. We always start during these 50 days after Jesus' resurrection by saying in Ge'ez, the Ethiopian language, Christos tansa mutan ba'abi hail wa sultan asaro la shaytan aga'azo la adam salam imi izessa kona fasaha wa salam. In English it says Christ has risen from the dead by the highest power and authority. He chained Satan. He freed Adam. Peace. Henceforth, prevail joy and peace. My topic for today's sermon is why was Jesus Christ crucified and raised? At this point, we are on Easter feast, celebrating the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, our Savior who leaves the tomb, our Lord who steps out of the darkness, our God who overcomes death, our King who destroyed the works of the devil, and most importantly, our Savior who brings us new life. In Romans chapter 4, we are going to look detail, especially in verse 25. I want to begin by reading the passage. Romans chapter 4, verse 23. 24 and 25. Now it was not written for his sake alone that it was imputed to him, but for us also, to whom it shall be imputed, if we believe on him that raised up Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was delivered for our offenses and was raised again for our justification. My preaching is based on verse 25. Jesus was delivered for our offenses and was raised again for our justification. The blessed St. Paul summarizes the gospel by this phrase, Romans 4:25. Was delivered for our offenses and was raised again for our justification. It's a massive implication of the resurrection of our Lord and our God, Jesus Christ. It is this that caused our justification. So before we go any further, let me give you the meaning of the words offense and justification in different languages, especially in Greek and Latin, and the origin of these two words, offense and justification. What does offense and justification mean? Two Greek words are translated offense, skandalon and proskoma. Both carry the connotation of sinfulness or stumbling block. This is offense. Justification in Greek, dikaiosis, is connected linguistically with righteousness or dikaiosune. In the first century, it is clear that all the words with this root were concerned with conformity to a standard of right. The word justification also derived from the Latin justificare. The literal meaning of the Latin is to make righteous. In Ge'ez, in Ethiopic, Romans chapter 4 verse 25 reads like this: ዘተሰቅለ በእንተ ኃጢአትነ ወተንሳ ከመያዝድቀነ ወከመያንሳአነ. So the word offense in Ge'ez is ኃጢአት, and the word justification, it means tzedek. By the way, what do you think about human restoration, redemption, and what is important to our salvation? In Romans chapter 4, verse 25, there are two parallel sections and two fundamental factors important to our salvation. Two parallel sections and two fundamental factors. It says, was delivered for our offenses and was raised again for our justification. So we can observe two very important things for our salvation. These are the death of our Lord and His resurrection among the dead. The death of our Lord and the resurrection of our Lord. First, the death of Christ to pay for our sin, was delivered for our offenses. And second, the resurrection of Christ to guarantee our resurrection and ultimate life with God, raised again for our justification. Let me give you the clarification. Let me give you some elucidation on the verse. Primarily, delivered over the days for our sins. What does it mean? Christ was delivered over to death for our sins, says the Spirit-inspired Apostle Paul. He delivered means. Look, the betrayal of Judas is recorded in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 26, verse 16. From verse 14 through 16, the Word of God says, then one of the 12, called Judas Iscariot, went unto the chief priests and said unto them, what will ye give me? And I will deliver him unto you. And they covenanted with him for 30 pieces of silver. And from that time he sought opportunity to betray him. Finally he did. He delivered Jesus over to the chief priests. Jesus was delivered over to death for our sins. He delivered over to Pilate by the elders of the people. The evangelist recorded in his gospel, Matthew 27, verse 1 to 2, he said that when the morning was come, all the chief priests and elders of the people took counsel against Jesus to put him to death. And when they had bound him, they led him away and delivered him to Pontius Pilate, the governor, who was delivered for our offenses. Pilate delivered Jesus over to the will of the people. Then Pilate took Jesus and flogged him, scourged him, tormented him. And the soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and put it on his head and arrayed him in a purple robe. They came up to him saying, "Hail, King of the Jews!" They struck him with their hands. Pilate went out again and said to them, "See, I am bringing him out to you, that you may know that I find no guilt in him." Pilate says, "I find no fault in this man." So Jesus came out, and wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe, Pilate said to them, "Behold the man." When the chief priests and the officers saw him, they cried out, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" And Jesus was delivered over to the soldiers to be crucified, was delivered for our wrongdoings. The four Gospels tell us that the chief priests, scribes, and Herod with his men of war arrayed him. According to the scripture, they dressed him in a purple robe in mockery, of course. But they also fulfilled the prophecy, doing so under inspiration. We know that Jesus Christ is called Lord of Lords, God of Gods, and King of Kings. So far, he was a king. However much they did it in a spirit of disrespect, still they did it. His royal dignity, our Lord royal dignity, our God royal dignity was symbolically heralded. So likewise, through it was with thorns they crowned him. Look, it was still a crown. By the way, let me ask you a question. Who crowned Jesus? Yeah, the soldiers. And it was soldiers who crowned him. Why the soldiers crowned him? Because kings are proclaimed by soldiers. Jesus is our King. And the benefit is for us. Our Lord Jesus was delivered for our offenses. God said through Isaiah the prophet, in Isaiah chapter 53 verse 5, it says, "But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed." You know, redemption comes by the precious blood of Christ. John also emphasized this point. In 1 John chapter 1, verse 7 to 10, "The blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. If you say that we have no sin, you are deceiving yourselves, and the truth is not in you. If you confess your sins, he is faithful and righteous, so that he will forgive you your sins and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. If we believe, the benefit is for redemption. Jesus was delivered for our offenses. He can heal us from all sin and from all unrighteousness." Let's move to the next main point. The second main point is that Jesus raised to life for our justification. Everything Jesus did is for our benefit, not for Him. He raised to life for our justification. First of all, let me ask you, is justification from sin by faith or works? Maybe your answer will be based on your denomination. For example, the founder of the Reformation Church, Martin Luther, declared his position. Justification is by faith alone. In Latin, it's called sola fide. Only faith. Faith alone. He demonstrates that our works are nothing to our justification. Incidentally, it was a great season in the Roman Catholic Church, and it was the beginning of the Protestant churches, the Reformation churches. According to the Ethiopian Orthodox Church, justification is by faith and works. To find a solution, look these two sections of the Bible. Romans chapter 4 verse 3 and James chapter 2 verse 24. Romans chapter 4 verse 3, it says, "For what doth the scripture say? And Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. Therefore, having been justified by faith." Look, here justification is by faith. Let me look at James chapter 2 verse 24. It reads like this. "You see that a man is justified by works, and not by faith alone. So, also faith without works is dead." Look, James chapter 2 verse 26. Faith without works is dead. The very two important fundamentals for our justification in the Ethiopian Orthodox Church are faith plus work. Faith without works is dead. Not only faith without works, and also works without faith is dead. So, Jesus' resurrection is for our justification. He was delivered over because of our wrongdoings and was raised because of our justification. Because Jesus Christ is raised from the dead, you walk in newness of life. The very conduct of your life is a testimony to the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The Bible tells us that because Christ rose from the dead, death has no more dominion over you. If you are a child of God, death has no more dominion over you. Though you are not sinless, sin is no longer your master. Jesus was delivered over because of our wrongdoings, our offenses, for our sins. He delivered. His own disciple Judas betrayed him. The Roman cohort and officers from the chief priests and the Pharisees came there with lanterns, torches, and weapons, and took him from the garden to a mockery trial. The Roman cohort, the commander, and the officers of the Jew arrested Jesus and bound him. They covered his face and slapped him around. spit in his face and took the reed and beat him on the head. They stripped him of his clothes and tied him to a whipping post. They placed a wooden cross on his injured back, took him to Calvary's Hill and drove nails into his hands and his feet and his side and his back. And above his head, the chief priests and the elders of the people put up the charge against him, which read, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews. He died in our place so that we could be forgiven of our sins." They buried him. They buried him in a tomb. However, Jesus was raised again for our justification. He alive. So we are not a slave to sin anymore. We have eternal life. Our name is written in the heaven, in the book of life. We will never die. The second death. If we believe that Jesus Christ was raised, we have everlasting life. I don't have to fear. I don't have to discourage. I don't have to despair. I don't have to worry. I don't have to distress. I don't have to fright. I don't have to panic. An angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled away the stone and sat upon it. And he said, "Don't be afraid." Do you hear me? "Don't be afraid" is the voice of the angel, and it's the voice of our Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus made his disciples and followers and said, "Rejoice." And they came up and worshipped him. He is the risen God. What does the Bible say about Jesus, the risen God? He is the risen God. The scripture said, he is the Alpha, he is the Omega. Who is and who was and who is to come? The Almighty. Look here. Five main adjectives for Jesus Christ. Number one, Jesus is the Alpha. Number two, he is the Omega. Number three, who is. Number four, who was. And number five, the Almighty, and who is to come. The name Almighty is a title only for God. Of course, Jesus is God. Jesus is the Creator. He is a mighty one. He is different from all religious founders and philosophers. Our Christianity, let me tell you, the true Christianity is so much more than just good morals. And Jesus is so much more than just a good moral teacher. It is about eternal life. It is confirmed by himself, our Lord and God Jesus. What makes Jesus different from other religious leaders? I can give you a lot of answers for this question, but for now, allow me to show you just three factors. First of all, he is God. You remember the verse in John chapter 1, verse 1 through verse 14. "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and he was in the beginning with God, and the Word became flesh." God became flesh. Jesus Christ is God, the incarnate. Secondly, the Son of Man came to give life. Jesus came to give his life. The Gospel of Mark, chapter 10, verse 45 says, "For even the Son of Man didn't come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many, to give his life for you, to give his life for me, and to give his life for us. Jesus is different. He came to give his life. He's different from any religious founders, any philosophers. And lastly, how is Jesus is unique from all other religious founders? He's the only one who is still alive. Look, Jesus is the only one who is still alive. All are dead and they're waiting Jesus' second coming. Glory be to God. Jesus is different. Our Lord is different because He is God's Almighty. Before finish my sermon, let me tell you the central teaching of my preaching today. We must understand that Jesus' crucifixion and His resurrection is for our advantage. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 4, "For I handed down to you as of first importance what I also received." Look here, three very important phrases. First, that Christ died for our sin according to the scripture. Two, and that He was buried according to the scriptures. And three, and that He was raised on the third day according to the scripture. According to the scripture, Christ died for our sin. According to the scripture, Christ was buried. According to the scripture, Christ was raised on the third day. What was the purpose? The reason? It was for our sin. The whole purpose is for our salvation, redemption, justification, sanctification. Our salvation is not guaranteed without the resurrection. Our salvation was completed when Jesus died on the cross. But the resurrection confirms it. We can be confident that we have been forgiven of our sins and have eternal life because Jesus didn't remain on the grave. Why? The grave could not hold Jesus. Because He is divine. He is the second person of the Trinity. He is God, the Son. Therefore, death had no victory over Him, over Jesus, over our Lord. Jesus did not remain on the grave. Why the grave could not hold Him? Because His divine power, because of His divine power, death could not hold Him. Already He told us in John chapter 11, verse 25, He, Jesus, say He was the resurrection and the life. That's why Jesus did not remain on the grave. Death could not hold Him because Jesus said, "Destroy this temple and in 3 days I will raise it up." So it was impossible to be held by death. For that reason, Christ rose from the dead, cause death could no longer hold Him, and we no longer have to fear death, cause Christ has triumphed over it. The scripture says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 55 to 57. Oh, death, where is your victory? Oh, death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus is the risen God. Jesus is the risen Lord, who is victorious over death, recognized by his disciples, acknowledged by his followers, and validated and confirmed by Scripture. Christ crucified and resurrected. Why? Why was Jesus delivered over to death for our sins? Why was he pierced for our transgressions? Cause of sin. Christ wiped away our sins by his death and rising again in the same state as the one in which he died. He appeared to believers. He appeared to the apostles. He appeared to the disciples in order to confirm our righteousness. If you have risen together with our Lord Jesus Christ, who is our justification? And we now walk in newness of life and live according to righteousness. Then Christ has risen for the purpose of our justification. We cannot be apprehended by death. We cannot be held by death. We cannot be seized by death. We cannot be detained by death. For by the Savior's passion, death is vanquished. Death is overcome. Death is overpowered. Death is defeated. And death is crushed forever. Once death was dominant, cause of sin, but it doesn't dare to hang on to those who have been justified by God. Jesus is alive. Our Lord is alive. Our God is alive. Death has lost its victory and the grave has been denied. The curse of sin is broken and Jesus lives forever. He is alive. He is alive forever. He is the Alpha and the Omega, the first and last. Behold, now is the day of salvation. It's your day of salvation. It is now, not yesterday. It is your day of salvation. It is now, not tomorrow. Yesterday is gone. Tomorrow has not yet come. You don't know what is going on tomorrow in your life and this world. I can tell you that you don't have full control of the future. Definitely, I know one thing. We have only today. Now is the day of salvation. It is now, just now. We have to start to build a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Make him your Lord. Make him your King. Make him your God. And even make him a friend like Lazarus, Martha, and Mary. Speak to him throughout your day. Asking questions, sharing ideas. Then you listen the words that he is your resurrection and your life. As we celebrate the resurrection today, remember people who don't know joy this day, and we pray for those who are experiencing physical or emotional torture and persecution in Ethiopia and in the world. Today, we who are carnal Mind the things of the flesh, and do the works of the flesh, and walk in the way of the flesh. But do you teach us the work of the Spirit? Make us understand the law of the Spirit, and lead us to the way of the Spirit. Remember not against us former iniquities. Let your tender mercies, O God, O Jesus, speedily precede us. O God, towards you we pray. O God, towards you we cry. O God, towards you we weep until endless ages. Let us give glory to the Lord above, and let us give veneration to His Holy Virgin Mother and the precious cross. The Lord's name be thanked and glorified always at all moments and times. Glory be to God, who is glorified in His saints. God bless you all. It's Happy Easter, not Easter Bunny. It is our life. It is our justification. It's our sanctification. It's our redemption. It's our restoration. Who was delivered for our offenses and was raised again for our justification. Happy Easter again. Malcolm Fasika. Unquan Adarasachu. Glory be to God forever. Amen.